Well, yeah, there's a beautiful bird called the mourning dove that lives here. And yeah, so it makes a sound. Let me see if I can do it here. But you'll hear it. And I remember when one of my nephews, when he was young, and I was telling him about the mourning dove, and he was confused and asked me, he says, well, it's the afternoon and the mourning dove is calling, so why would they call it a mourning dove? And so I told him, hey, there are two ways to spell mourning, and in this case the dove gets its name from the mourning, because the sound it makes is very sort of plaintive and sad, and but it's very, very beautiful, very like calming. There was one in the distance just a moment ago I could hear. This land was farmed, I think the first people who farmed it, the Europeans who farmed it, came in the 1870s, and they built a winery and had cattle as well. And my parents, they always loved, you know, wine, and especially Bordeaux style wine. And so that's what prompted them to want to, plant grapes and try to make wine. There's an old cattle barn that was built in the 1870s, and when we arrived, the roof was falling in, and it was a really old structure. You could see the timbers that held the roof up were cut from the forest, and you could see the knots in the wood and the former branches there. And so they decided to rehabilitate that old milking barn and turn it into a winery. And so we began to then use some of our grapes to make wine.
I had a friend who was the winemaker here, my predecessor, a guy named Jeremy Weintraub, who was the winemaker at Seavey Vineyard prior to my arrival. And when he was leaving to go take another job, he asked me if I was interested to come. And I'd actually been out to visit him in the estate before, and so I kind of seen how beautiful and picturesque this estate is. When the Seaveys first started planting this ranch in the early 80s, down at the base of the hill, they were planting Chardonnay because there was a great need for Chardonnay, a commercial need. And then as Cabernet was becoming more and more popular within the Napa Valley, Bill Seavey started planting Cabernet in the more steep hillsides as he was coming up the hills. And in making those early wines, just kind of very much realized that Cabernet was so ideally suited to the microclimate that we have here. Cabernet is obviously king in Napa Valley. My background was working in vineyards with very flat, big expanses. And so coming here was a bit of a mind bender, but I've come to find this to be just so much more interesting. In growing grapes in a hillside vineyard such as this ranch here, it sort of forces everything to be smaller. This vineyard operation has to be on a smaller scale than if we were on flat land, just simply because each vine has its imprint, it's fixed in the soil. And the composition of the soil in this piece may be slightly different than a few meters this way. And so what we need to do is we need to sort of find the pockets of similarity in the soil and the topography. No.
La uva requiere también de aire, que corre el viento por el medio de su de sus ramas, y estamos deshojándola para que produzca mejor fruta y la uva se desarrolle mejor y agarre más fuerza.
Overall, the wine, I'm thinking as the winemaker, thinking what the final wine is going to be like in terms of flavors and most importantly textures. And so we want those grapes to be rich, want the tannins to be ripe in that section that we identify. And that work all starts in identifying and finding small pieces in the vineyard that are sort of similar in their physiology, just based on their relationship to the soil and the sun and the wind and rain.
In 2020, my brother Will and I were here. We had two big wildfires, one on the ridge there and then one back to the west of us. But massive fires, and Will and I stayed behind, you know, the sheriff came to evacuate people, but we stayed back to try to protect the land. But we spent something, yeah, like 5 days in the smoke without electricity, and we would sleep in shifts so that one of us was awake at all times and preparing for the fire. Before the Europeans arrived here, the native people would use fire as a way of managing the forest and keeping down the, you know, maintaining it in a form that was healthy for the forest. But when Europeans came, they outlawed that practice. And so our forests are overstocked, and they have huge buildups of fuels on the forest floor, dead fuels.
We're doing a great deal of work to clear fuels in the forest behind me here. There's a lot of old manzanita wood that we've dragged into piles, burned the piles, made biochar, something that we actually integrate back in with our compost and get into the vineyard soil to sequester carbon.
In Brazil, they found in the Amazon jungle large mounds of charcoal that the native people deposited there, and it's very fertile soil. And even after hundreds and hundreds of years, it remains fertile.
I've done a lot of work hardening the winery, but it always sits. It's a bit of anxiety. I think everyone feels it in their stomach. Every winemaker, or anyone really that lives in the community, feels sort of a pit of anxiety in their stomach when the warm winds start blowing on August and September.
I think that farmers for thousands of years have worked hand in hand with animals, and really Westerners now were fascinated with tractors and equipment of that sort, but trying to use animals to do some of the work that traditionally we've done. So rather than, for example, mowing between the vines using sheep and grazing cattle and using goats, and so we have cattle, sheep, goats, chickens, but to try to work in a complementary fashion you know, with our ecosystem. It's also fun, I mean, to work with animals, and you come to form a community with them.
Oh.
Yes, see, the worm farm. But basically, these are wood shavings, these shelving units, and each of these is filled with worms. And from the winery floor, let's say we're harvesting grapes and there are pieces of grape skins, of the grape stems, other organic material. And so we bring that here and it sprays into the worm bins. And then the worms eat that organic material. And they produce, you know, a worm tea. And then we take that, the worm tea that ends up, and we apply it to the vineyard or to fruit trees or other parts of the land.
I spend 6 months of the year alone in this cave. It's very quiet. It takes a certain personality, I think, to be able to work alone in an environment like this. I do enjoy it. But I am limited, obviously, by not having a lot of people to work with. I'm limited in conversations that I can have about technical aspects of winemaking. And so I developed the podcast 10 years ago in 2014 to have a chance to give me an opportunity to go out and to talk to other winemakers and grape growers. And sometimes I ask them about certain technical issues that I'm cogitating in my brain as I'm in the cellar. Or sometimes if they're working with different grapes, I want to learn about working with, you know, Pinot Noir or Grenache or some of these other grapes that I'm not working with here at this you know, quite small estate. And so the podcast sort of is it's a way to leverage an audience to be able to sit down and focus with someone and have this longer conversation. And from that, I've had so many tremendous, you know, ideas and different opportunities come that it's been a way to balance my sort of introvert that can work alone in this cave and then also make sure that I'm continuing to learn and become a better winemaker, make sure I don't get locked into my own ideas. I want to make sure to remain flexible and open to new things and understand what people are doing in other wineries. Not just in Napa, but throughout California and to some degree, you know, other winemaking regions throughout the world.
No, I remember when my dad passed away, we had a memorial service for him inside of our winery, and he had this longtime friend and who spoke at the memorial service, and we had just a gathering and showed photos and people spoke, and then we had a meal together. But one of his friends, and she comes from France and her family has made wine for multiple generations, and she said, "I remember when Bill Seavey said, 'I'm going to make wine,' and she said to her, this Californian is crazy. He knows nothing about making wine." And so, you know, he said they did it, and it like turned out to be really good wine. Like, and she just didn't think it would be possible to do it. But I think it's, a way that one cares for the land and the attention you pay to the vines and the process and the people, and is the key to try to work in synchrony with all of the things around us.